It's really my pleasure to just to bring up Pastor Honi Serapanji and also his wife, Sister Lenny. You'll meet her. And also we have Brother Ephraim and his wife, Imelda. And she is, Sister Imelda is going to be interpreting. And what you'll do is you'll see pretty much what happens whenever we travel around the world. This is how we preach too. I'm not saying qualitatively, but this is how we preach with an interpreter. But so you'll see. So Pastor Honi, I'm not saying I'm as good a preacher as you. You were throwing it out there this morning. And I sure was blessed by it. I think we were also blessed by you preaching. So would you, he pastors a church there in Manado, Indonesia. And this is, I think that when I was there, it was a largely Christian area. Yeah, and it still is. They've done a superb job there in Indonesia. Indonesia is the largest Muslim country in the world. And sometimes there are incidences where they don't too much like Christians. And so you'll read about that and hear those things in the news. But he is there and his family preaching the word of God. We're glad you're in Corpus Christi, Texas, the body of Christ. Corpus Christi is the body of Christ. So come on up and share the word of God with us. Pastor Honi.
Morning. Come on, Avaim. Thank you for 1 hour. This is my wife, Lenny. We have three children, Stefan, Stephanie, and Stella, and two grandchild, Elora and Kenneth. We live in Indonesia in one city named Manado, and Pastor Don was there in 2019. Okay, kami datang berempat.
So we came here, the four of us came here.
Dengan, five. Yeah, and she is a second best translator in Houston. The first one passed away. Introduce yourself.
Okay. My name is Imelda, and this is my husband, Ephraim. We actually came with our daughter, but she just came from summer camp, so she's tired. She's in the hotel right now.
Yeah, I think I can speak English, but I'm not sure. So I need help from Imelda. Okay, thank you very much. Sit down. You know, satu hari saya duduk merenung di kantor saya.
One day I was sitting at my office and thinking about something.
And I remember that, dan saya ingat tahun ini.
And I remember that this year,
22 Agustus,
August the 22nd,
my birthday,
would be my birthday.
Yang ke-60 tahun.
And I'm turning 60.
60 tahun. Saya ingat 30 tahun di dalam pelayanan.
And I remember the same, this year is also my 30 year of ministry.
Lalu saya bertanya dalam hati saya, siapa yang akan, saya bertanya dalam hati saya untuk melakukan sesuatu.
So I was thinking and asking the Lord, who's going to preach at the celebration?
Saya pikir ketua sinode kami.
I thought that would be the chair of our church organization.
Organisasi kami mempunyai kira-kira 7,000 gereja lokal.
Our church organizations has 7,000 local churches.
Dengan 3,500 jemaat.
With 3.5 million members.
In Indonesia.
In Indonesia.
Tetapi hati saya belum connect.
But my heart was still conflicting.
And I remember one name.
And I remember one name.
Donald Liver.
Donald Liver.
Yang pernah datang ke gereja kami di tahun 2019.
Who came to our church in 2019.
Dan dia berbicara tentang Yesus dengan sangat kuat.
And he preached about Jesus strongly.
Ya, yeah, dan saya ingat satu pendeta yang mengatur perjalanan Pastor Don di Indonesia.
So it came to my mind a name of one of the pastors who was organizing the trip at that time.
Namanya Pendeta Arthur.
His name is Pastor Arthur.
Dan saya telepon dia, Pastor, so apa kabar Pastor Don?
So I called Pastor Arthur and asked Pastor Don's how is he doing?
Kapan dia datang ke Indonesia?
So I asked Pastor Arthur, when is Pastor Donald is gonna come?
Dan dia mengatakan saya sedang mengatur jadwalnya.
And to my surprise, Pastor Arthur said that I'm organizing, I'm doing the schedule right now for his coming to Indonesia.
Ya? When?
So I asked, when is he coming?
Dan dia mengatakan Agustus.
And Pastor Arthur said, this August.
Dan saya mengatakan, please tanya Pastor Don apakah dia bisa datang ke Manado 22 Agustus.
So I asked Pastor Arthur, could you please ask Pastor Don if he would be willing to come August the 22nd in Manado?
Saya tidak tahu apa yang Pastor Don sampaikan kepada Pastor Arthur.
I don't know what did Pastor Don says to Pastor Arthur.
Tetapi satu hal yang saya tahu.
But one thing that I know.
Orang yang akan berbicara di dalam ulang tahun saya.
That the person who's going to preach on my birthday celebration.
Mari kita buka Alkitab kita, saudara-saudara.
So let's turn to our Bible.
Lukas pasal 19 ayat 1.
Luke 19.
Sampai ayat yang ke-10.
Verse 1 to 10. And let me read it. Luke 19, 1 to 10. Jesus comes to Zacchaeus' house. Then Jesus entered and passed through Jericho. Now behold, there was a man named Zacchaeus who was a chief tax collector, and he was rich. And he sought to see who Jesus was, but could not because of the crowd, for he was of short stature. So he ran ahead and climbed up into a sycamore tree to see him.
Okay. Bapak Ibu, dikatakan bahwa Yesus masuk ke kota Jericho.
So Jesus came to the town of Jericho.
Jericho adalah kota yang paling rendah di muka bumi.
So Jericho was at the lowest point on earth.
Lowest city on earth. Ya. Dan saya telah datang ke kota ini 40 kali.
So I've been to this city 40 times.
40 times. Dan saya sangat senang dengan local food.
And I really love their local food.
Yummy. Tetapi persoalan, saudara-saudara, adalah kenapa dikatakan dan Yesus berjalan terus melintasi kota itu.
Now take a look on verse 1. Jesus entered and passed through the city.
Jika Yesus benar-benar melintasi kota ini.
So if Jesus passed through the city,
ayat 10 harus dihapuskan.
We probably need to delete verse 10 that says the Son of Man has come to seek and save that which
karena banyak was lost. Orang di dalam kota itu adalah orang-orang terhilang.
Because there are many lost people in that city.
Apakah arti Jericho?
What does Jericho mean?
Jericho artinya kota pohon korma.
Jericho means the city of
palm tree, kota pohon korma, dan Jericho adalah kota wangi-wangian,
and also the city of aroma,
aromatic city. Jericho 300 meter di bawah permukaan laut.
Jericho is located 300 meter below the sea level.
Yerusalem 800 meter di atas permukaan laut.
And Jerusalem is 100 meters above the sea level.
Pada musim dingin, Jericho akan tetap hangat dibandingkan dengan Yerusalem.
And during the winter, Jericho will remain hot or warm compared to Jerusalem.
Ada yang mengatakan perbedaannya in Celsius 10 derajat.
It's about 10 degrees Celsius difference between Jericho and Jerusalem.
Sehingga pada musim-musim tertentu orang-orang yang ada di Yerusalem akan menjadikan Jericho ini kota wisata.
So in certain season, those people from Jerusalem, they'll come to visit Jericho as part of their vacation or doing tourism there.
Kenapa Yesus berjalan terus melintasi kota itu?
So why did Jesus keep walking through the city or keep passing through the city?
Saudara-saudara, sebab kota itu tidak rohani.
Because that city is not so spiritual.
Hal yang kedua adalah kota itu adalah kota yang pernah dikutuk oleh Yosua.
And then the second thing is that the city of Jericho was cursed once by Joshua.
Ketika Israel masuk ke kota itu dan mengelilingi kota itu dan kota itu runtuh.
When the Israelites was walking around that city and the city was and the wall was demolished.
Yosua bernubuat.
Joshua prophesied.
Dengan mengorbankan anaknya yang sulung, orang membangun tembok kota.
By sacrificing his eldest sons to build the wall.
Dan dengan mengorbankan anaknya yang bungsu, orang membangun pintu gerbangnya.
To sacrifice the youngest to build the city gate.
Dan ada seorang yang kemudian hari bernama Hiel.
And then there's a person's name Hiel.
Dengan mengorbankan anaknya yang sulung dan anaknya yang bungsu, dia membangun tembok dan pintu gerbangnya.
At that time, he sacrificed his youngest and his eldest sons to build the city wall and the city gate.
Jadi pendapat saya adalah.
So in my opinion,
Yesus tidak mau datang ke kota itu karena kota itu kota yang tidak rohani.
That Jesus wouldn't come to that city because the city was not spiritual at
kota
that time.
Kota yang ada di bawah kutuk.
It was under the curse.
Dengarkan, saudara-saudara.
Listen to this.
Jika ada kutuk di dalam hidup kita, maka Tuhan tidak akan datang kepada kita.
If there was a curse in our life, that God will not come and visit us.
Kutuk apa yang banyak ada di dalam kehidupan kita?
What kind of curses?
Kutuk dosa.
The curse of sin.
Pelanggaran akan hukum Tuhan.
The curse of the sin.
Yeah, that's sin.
Sins. Yeah, dan, the curse of sins.
Saudara-saudara, kutuk yang datang dari nenek moyang kita.
At the curse who comes from our generations before us.
Sebab Alkitab berkata, aku akan membalaskan kesalahan bapa kepada anaknya, kepada keturunan yang ketiga dan yang keempat.
Because the Bible says that I will return the sins of your fathers to your third and fourth generation.
Itu sebabnya saudara-saudara, untuk melepaskan kutuk itu,
therefore, in order to break that curses,
Yesus harus masuk ke dalam kehidupan kita.
Jesus need to come to our life.
Ketika Yesus masuk ke dalam kehidupan kita, kita menjadi orang percaya.
When Jesus comes to our life and we become believers,
dan melakukan firman,
and do the word of God,
firman apa yang harus kita lakukan untuk memutuskan kutuk itu?
Then we have to do the word of God to break the curses.
Baptisan air.
The first one is the immersions, the baptisms by immersion.
Sebab Alkitab berkata baptisan air adalah menguburkan manusia lama.
Because the Bible says that when we are baptized, we bury our old self.
Dan membangkitkan manusia baru.
And then the new man is rising up.
Jubah yang lama ditanggalkan.
Our old robe is taken off.
Jubah yang baru akan datang.
And we receive the new robes.
Katakan amin.
Say amen.
Tuhan Yesus berkata kepada Nikodemus.
Jesus said to Nicodemus,
jika engkau tidak dilahirkan dari air dan roh,
if you were not born from water and spirit,
engkau tidak akan masuk ke dalam kerajaan.
You will never enter to my kingdom.
Saudara-saudara, my mother, my grandpa for my mother, my grandpa for my mother, mempunyai 3 istri.
So my grandpa has 3 wives.
3 wives. Yeah? Yang resmi.
Official wives, married.
Yeah, the other one I don't know. My grandpa from my father mempunyai 16 istri.
And my grandpa from my father's side has 16 wives.
yang ketahuan.
who do we know officially married?
The other one we don't know. Saudara-saudara, dan dia beragama Islam.
The wives?
No, my grandpa from my
mom. Oh, okay. My grandpa from my mom's side was a Muslim.
That's why he has 16.
That's why he had 16 wives.
Saudara-saudara, tidak ada peluang kami menjadi orang Kristen.
So there was no chance at that time for us to be a Christian.
Tidak ada peluang kami menjadi hamba Tuhan.
There was not a chance for us to be
pastors. Tetapi tahun 1992.
But in 1992.
29 April.
April the 29th.
Mama, papa saya, mama saya, kakak saya, istrinya dan kakak perempuan saya dan istri saya.
My parents, my brother, his wife, and my wife.
Kami melakukan baptisan air.
We did the baptism, water baptism.
Dan kemudian Tuhan merubah kehidupan kami sekeluarga.
And God changed the life of our family.
Tadi pagi saya menyaksikan.
So this morning I witnessed.
Saya bekerja di perusahaan bir.
That I used to work in a beer company.
Dan hidup saya rusak.
And my life was at mess.
Saya menjadi peminum.
I was an alcoholic.
Hidup di nightclub.
I live from nightclubs to nightclubs.
Saya perokok, rokok Indonesia, kretek Indonesia.
I was a heavy smoker of Indonesian cigars.
Cigar, 4 boxes a day. Sangat mengerikan. Saya pergi dari rumah jam 8 pagi. Saya pulang ke rumah jam 4 pagi.
So it was an awful life because I used to leave the house at 8 a.m. and then get home at 4 a.m. the next morning.
Dan saya menjadi orang asing di dalam rumah saya sendiri.
And I became the strangers at my own house.
Waktu itu saya sudah punya 2 anak.
At that time I already had 2 children.
Dan seringkali anak saya tidak mau dekat kepada papanya.
And at times that my children didn't want to get close to me.
Karena baunya macam-macam.
Because of the smell of the cigar.
Dari banyak orang di sekeliling saya, perempuan-perempuan yang tidak baik.
And I was surrounded by many women at that time.
Tetapi kemudian Tuhan merubah kehidupan kami.
But God changed our life.
Rumah saya menjadi home sweet home.
My house becomes home sweet home.
Tuhan merubah kehidupan kami.
God changed our life.
Saudara-saudara, karena melakukan firman Tuhan.
Because we did the word of God.
Tidak boleh ada kutuk di dalam kehidupan kita.
There is no curse in our life.
Barangkali itu karena perkataan kita.
Sometimes it's because of our words.
Ada orang berkata, saya orang miskin.
You know, sometimes we say, oh, I'm a poor.
Saya tidak bisa apa-apa.
I cannot do anything.
Perkataan itu harus dicabut.
That kind of words needs to be rooted up.
Dalam nama Tuhan Yesus.
In the name of Jesus.
Mungkin ada orang tua berkata kepada anaknya, kamu bodoh.
Or maybe your parents say that you are a fool.
You cannot do anything.
You can.
Itu mesti dicabut.
That we need to cancel that.
Yesus.
Cancel in the name of Jesus.
Tidak boleh menjadi kutuk di dalam kehidupan
it
kita.
It cannot be a curse in our life.
Katakan amin.
Say amen.
Now, kita kembali ke Lukas pasal 19.
Okay.
Dikatakan di situ ada seorang bernama Zakheus, kepala pemungut cukai, dan ia seorang kaya.
There was a man named Zakheus who was a chief tax collector and he was rich.
Tuhan Yesus bilang begini di pasal 18.
In verse 8, chapter 18, Jesus says,
orang kaya susah masuk surga.
That it is difficult for a rich man to enter heaven.
Lebih mudah seekor unta masuk ke dalam lubang jarum.
It is easier for
a camel
to enter the eye of a needle.
Daripada orang kaya masuk surga.
Than the rich one.
Anda mau kaya?
Do you want to become rich?
Ada yang mau kaya?
Anyone
susah masuk surga.
Anyone wants to become rich, but you. difficult to enter heaven.
This is not my word.
This is not my word.
Ini perkataan Tuhan Yesus.
This is Jesus saying.
Kenapa orang kaya susah masuk surga?
Why do you think the rich man is difficult to enter heaven?
Sebab hatinya tidak kepada Tuhan.
Because his heart is not toward the Lord.
Hatinya kepada harta bendanya.
Because his heart is on the money.
Zacchaeus ini orang kaya.
Zacchaeus is a rich man.
Dan tidak punya peluang untuk diselamatkan.
And Zacchaeus didn't have any chance to be saved at that time.
Tapi dia melakukan sesuatu yang membuka pintu surga baginya.
But he did something that opened the door for him.
Di ayat yang ketiga dikatakan ia berusaha untuk melihat orang apakah Yesus itu.
First three says he sought to see who Jesus was. But he could not because of the crowd.
Maka berlarilah ia mendahului orang banyak lalu memanjat pohon ara untuk melihat Yesus yang akan lewat di situ.
So he ran ahead and climbed up into a sycamore tree to see him.
Bapak Ibu, di Jericho makanan yang ada di sana very sweet.
So in Jericho the food there is kind of sweet.
Dan banyak lemaknya.
And so greasy.
Saya diberi makan Pastor Don kemarin steak 16 ounce.
Pastor Don had a meal with us and I ate steak 16 ounces steak.
The big one. Saya tidak bisa menghabiskannya.
I couldn't finish it though.
Too big for me. Saudara-saudara, saya membayangkan Zacchaeus ini badannya pendek, makannya banyak, big.
So I imagine Zacchaeus must be, he ate a lot, so.
Big size.
Yeah, he's a big size guy and a short stature.
Tidak mudah baginya untuk panjat pohon ara.
I think it's difficult for him to climb up to the sycamore
secara
tree.
Secara fisik susah bagi dia untuk bertemu dengan Yesus.
Physically, it was difficult for him to meet Jesus.
Dan saya mau memberitahu saudara.
But let me tell you.
Zacchaeus ini orang yang terlambat.
Zacchaeus is
late man.
Is a late man.
Orang sudah berbondong-bondong ikut Tuhan, tapi Zacchaeus baru bangun.
So the crowd was already following Jesus, but Zacchaeus was left behind.
Alkitab mengatakan yang terdahulu akan menjadi terkemudian.
As the Bible says that the one who comes before may come to the last.
Hati-hati saudara yang sudah Kristen lama.
So be careful if we have been a Christian for a while.
Jangan orang yang baru bertobat kemarin akan lebih dahulu masuk surga.
Don't let the new believers go to heaven ahead of us.
Kita yang sudah bertahun-tahun jadi Kristen, jangan sampai kita ketinggalan.
And don't let us who have been a Christians for a long time don't let left behind.
Saudara kasih dalam Tuhan, Zacchaeus secara jasmani membayar harga untuk bertemu dengan Tuhan.
So physically Zacchaeus had to pay the price to meet Jesus.
Tetapi yang paling mengagumkan dari apa yang dilakukan oleh Zacchaeus adalah,
and this is what amazing thing that Zacchaeus did.
Gairahnya untuk bertemu dengan Tuhan.
That his passion.
Dia berusaha untuk melihat siapakah Yesus itu.
He was making efforts to come and seek Jesus.
Ketika kami bertobat tahun 92,
When I received Christ in 1992,
muncul satu gairah yang sangat besar dalam hati kami untuk bertemu dengan Tuhan.
There was a great desire in us to meet Jesus.
Saya ingat satu hari ada something like a seminar di kota lain di Indonesia.
I remember that one day there was a seminar in another town in Indonesia.
Kami harus naik mobil ke ibu kota 310 kilo.
And then we had to drive about 300 kilometers to that city.
Dan kemudian kami naik kapal satu malam ke kota yang lain.
And we need to continue by ship overnight to another city.
Dan kami menginap di rumah sakit.
And then we had to spend the night in a hospital.
Tempat di mana tamu-tamu luar kota menginap untuk mengikuti seminar itu.
The hospital where another, people coming from another town, they had to spend the night in that hospital.
Ketika acara itu mulai, kami datang pagi-pagi jam 7 di depan gedung itu.
We had to be at outside of the building around 7 a.m. that morning.
Ada elevator.
There was an elevator in the building.
Nobody there. Dan kami kemudian antri di depan lift. Gedung itu belum buka.
So we had to stood in line.
Ketika lift itu dibuka pada jam 8 pagi.
When the elevator was begin to start at 8 a.m.
Kami cepat-cepat masuk ke dalamnya, naik lift ke atas.
We rushed in and then got taken up to the second floor.
Dan kami masuk dari pintu di sana.
Then we enter from that door, from dan the side
kami,
door.
Dan kami berlari ke depan, duduk di second line.
And we ran to find to the second row.
The problem is nobody there.
And the problem was nobody there.
Belum ada orang di sana. Dan kami berlomba datang untuk duduk di depan. Ah, thank you Lord. Terima kasih Tuhan, kami sudah ada dalam gedung.
So no one's there, but we ran to find the second row.
Muncul satu gairah yang besar.
There was a big passion and desire
untuk mendengarkan firman.
To listen to the word of God.
Dan mengikuti ibadah.
And join that service.
Zacchaeus melakukan ini, saudara-saudara.
So that's what Zacchaeus did.
Dia punya gairah untuk mencari Tuhan.
He was so passionate.
Dia memakai semua daya tenaganya untuk mencari Tuhan.
He used all his might and strength to seek the Lord.
Dia memakai talentanya panjat pohon, padahal dia orang yang tidak cocok untuk naik ke pohon.
He used his talents to climb up to the tree. He is not capable of doing that, probably.
He is not a climber, I think. Tetapi dia mau melakukan itu hanya untuk melihat Yesus.
He wanted to do it just to see Jesus.
Sudah kasih dalam Tuhan, gairah kita mencari Tuhan.
So our passion in seeking the Lord
pasti diperhitungkan oleh Tuhan.
Will be counted by
Ketika
the Lord.
Ketika kita mencari Tuhan,
when we seek the Lord
dan mengandalkan Tuhan
and trust in him,
maka persoalan kita akan diselesaikan oleh Tuhan.
That he will solve our problems.
Ada satu cerita.
There is a story.
Seorang bapak membawa anak perempuannya umur 5 tahun masuk ke dalam sebuah lift.
So there was a father with a 5-year-old girl. They were going into the escalator.
Okay, you can drink your water. You know, for this father, enter to the elevator, no problem. But not for his daughter. His daughter, karena dia pendek, maka yang dia lihat kiri kanan adalah.
Oh, so it was easier for the father to enter the elevator, but not for the daughter, because the daughter was, you know, still small. So and, everything that he saw, just the behind.
Yang dia lihat. Ketika lift itu naik, ketika lift itu mulai naik.
Okay, so when the elevator start moving up.
Anak ini mulai gelisah.
So the little daughter start being restless.
Karena dia lihat kiri dan kanannya adalah.
Because everything that she saw at that time was the behind of the people.
Behind? Saudara-saudara, tetapi tiba-tiba dia ingat dia masuk ke dalam elevator dengan papanya.
And then one day she remembers that she's already in the elevator with her parents.
Dan dia mulai tarik celana papanya. Daddy, pick me up.
Okay. So she pull her her father's.
Dan papanya melihat
to pick her up.
Dan papanya melihat kamu punya persoalan ya. Dan papanya menggendong dia.
And her father looked down and start picking her up.
Gampang sekali papanya menggendong dia.
It was so easy for her father to pick her up and hold her.
Sudah perhatikan, anak ini masih ada di dalam persoalan yang sama.
So pay attention is that this daughter is still in the same problem.
Tetapi sekarang dengan dia melihat dengan cara pandang papanya.
Oh, because she's being picked up, now she's seeing from a different perspective. From a higher perspective.
Ketika dia ada di bawah, dia bisa mencari jalan untuk pergi menekan tombol.
When she was still on the ground, you know, she could find a way to push the button at the elevator.
Mungkin karena dia pendek, dia nomor 6.
Probably because she was short at that time, she could just, you know, push the button number 6.
Dan dia berdiri di depan pintu lift itu, dan pintu lift itu pasti akan terbuka di lantai 6, dan kemudian dia keluar, persoalan saya selesai.
She could be standing near the door after pushing the button, and she could just think that my problem is solved. Now I can see another room.
Dan memang dia akan sampai ke lantai 6, persoalannya selesai, tidak lagi melihat ini, tapi dia tidak akan sampai kepada tujuan papanya di lantai yang paling atas.
So yes, she could get off on the sixth floor by pushing the button. However, she's not going to be able to get to the destinations of her father.
Banyak kali orang Kristen mencari jalan pintas.
Sometimes we find a shortcuts.
Tetapi kalau kita selesai dengan jalan pintas, kita tidak mencapai tujuan Tuhan di dalam kehidupan kita.
But if we only take shortcuts, we will not get to the destination of our God.
Amen.
Amen.
Saudara-saudara, ketika elevator itu naik sampai di atas.
When the elevator gets to the top.
Mungkin lantai 92 seperti Summit One di downtown Manhattan.
Maybe up to the floor number 92, like the Summit One in Manhattan.
Kami sudah ada di sana minum kopi.
We were there drinking coffee there.
Dan di atas anak itu akan berkata, papa lihat itu mobil di bawah kecil.
When she's on the top, she can tell to her father, look at those car, become so small.
Bapak Ibu, ketika kita punya persoalan, naiklah ke atas.
So when we have problems, go to a higher level.
Di atas kita akan bersama-sama dengan Tuhan.
When we go to a higher level with God,
di atas kita akan melihat persoalan kita kecil.
Then we will see our problems so small down there.
Banyak orang Kristen ketika punya persoalan, dia selalu ada di bawah.
Many Christians, when we encounter problem, we stay down.
Dan dia berkata, Tuhan, persoalanku besar.
And we look up and say, God, my problem is so big.
Tapi kalau kita naik ke atas,
but when we go up,
Tuhan kita besar, persoalan kita akan menjadi kecil.
And then our problem is small.
Itulah orang yang mengandalkan Tuhan.
And that's the God-fearing.
Itulah orang yang mencari Tuhan.
And that's how we seek the Lord.
Sudah tahu Zakheus tidak disukai oleh orang-orang yang ada di kotanya.
Zacchaeus is not a likable person in his city at
that time. Maka ketika Yesus masuk ke dalam rumahnya, banyak orang yang bersungut-sungut.
So when Jesus came and entered his house, many people grumbled.
Mari kita melihat cerita ini.
Let's go back to
ayat yang kelima.
Verse 5. And when Jesus came to the place, he looked up and saw him and said to him, Zacchaeus, make haste and come down, for today I must stay at your house.
Saudara-saudara, satu-satunya rumah yang ada di Yeriko yang dimasuki oleh Tuhan adalah rumah Zacchaeus.
The only house in Jericho at that time that Jesus entered was Zacchaeus' house.
Only one house. Saya percaya begini, Bapak Ibu. Yeriko itu adalah kota yang hijau, banyak pohon.
I believe Jericho was a green city. There are many trees there.
Salah satu namanya adalah hamparan karpet di padang gurun.
And they call Jericho as like a green carpet.
Green carpet.
And the desert.
Saudara-saudara, banyak pohon di kota Jericho.
There are many trees in Jericho.
Dan saya percaya banyak orang di atas pohon-pohon itu.
And I also believe that there are many people climb on the trees at
yang mau melihat Yesus.
Who also wanted to see Jesus.
Tapi hanya satu pohon yang didatangi oleh Tuhan.
But there is only one tree that Jesus approach.
Pohonnya Zacchaeus.
The tree where Zacchaeus was climbed.
Berapa banyak orang Kristen di kota ini?
How many Christians in the cities?
Apakah rumah kita menarik perhatian Tuhan atau tidak?
Is our house attracted to the Lord to come visit us?
Berapa banyak gereja yang ada di Corpus Christi?
How many churches are in Corpus Christi?
Yang ada di Texas.
In Texas.
Apakah gereja kita ini menarik perhatian Tuhan atau tidak?
Is this church attracted to the Lord, Chris?
Saudara-saudara, Yesus datang ke pohon Zacchaeus bukan karena Tuhan memutuskan untuk datang ke pohon itu.
Jesus decided to come and approach the tree not because he decided to.
Karena dia mau berjalan melintasi kota itu.
Because Jesus at that time was about to pass through the city.
Tetapi ada satu panggilan yang datang dari Zacchaeus.
But there was a calling coming from Zacchaeus.
Yang mengundang Yesus datang ke pohonnya.
That invited Jesus, attracted Jesus
yang
to come.
Yang menarik perhatian Tuhan.
Attracted his attention.
Sehingga Tuhan mau datang ke pohon Zacchaeus.
So Jesus wanted to come to the tree of
Zacchaeus.
Bahkan
masuk ke dalam rumah Zacchaeus.
And enter his house.
Katakan amin.
Say amen to that.
Jadi siapakah yang memutuskan Tuhan mau datang ke dalam kehidupan kita?
Who decides for Jesus to come to our house?
You and I.
You and I.
Katakan amin. Katakan amin.
Amen.
Sikap kita kepada Tuhan.
Our attitude toward God
menentukan perlakuan Tuhan kepada kita.
Determine how God is going to treat us.
Ketika kita memiliki hasrat dan gairah bertemu dengan Tuhan.
When we have a desire, a passion to meet Jesus,
maka dia akan datang kepada kita.
He will come.
1 Korintus pasal 3 ayat 16 mengatakan.
1 Corinthians 3:16.
Tidak tahukah kamu bahwa tubuhmu adalah bait Allah?
Don't you know that your body is the temple of the Holy Spirit?
Dan bahwa Roh Allah diam di dalam kamu.
And the Holy Spirit lives in you.
Ayat 17.
The verse 17 says.
Siapa yang membinasakan bait Allah?
Who destroys the temple?
Akan dibinasakan oleh Allah.
Will be destroyed by the Lord.
Jadi orang Kristen yang sadar dan tahu bahwa Tuhan ada di dalam hidupnya.
So as Christians we know that God lives in us.
Dia akan
body,
tahu bagaimana bersikap dengan benar di hadapan Tuhan.
Then the person will know how to react, how to have an attitude before the Lord.
Saya mau katakan kepada saudara.
I want to tell you.
Alkitab mengatakan begini.
This is what the Bible says.
Ladang sudah menguning.
That the field is ripe.
Penuainya sedikit.
But the harvester is few.
Kenapa, saudara?
Do you know why?
Sebab banyak penuai-penuai tinggal nyaman di dalam gereja.
Because there are many harvesters who just stay comfortably at church.
Tidak mau pergi untuk melakukan tugasnya sebagai penuai-penuai.
They don't want to go out in the field and harvest.
Untuk menjadi berkat bagi banyak orang.
To become the blessings of many people.
Saudara-saudara, not easy for me to come here, Corpus Christi. Not easy for me and my wife. Not easy for her and her husband to come to this city. Tetapi kami mau datang ke kota ini.
But we decided to come to the city.
Sebab kami ingin menjadi berkat bagi banyak
because
orang.
We want to become the blessings to other people.
Alkitab mengatakan, jejakmu mengeluarkan lemak.
The Bible says that your steps will produce grease.
Lemak.
Oh, will produce grease. Or fat.
Fat. Bapak Ibu, apakah jejak kita dapat menjadi berkat bagi orang lain atau tidak?
Do you think that your steps will become the blessings
apakah
to other
kita
people?
Apakah kita dapat menjadi berkat bagi orang lain atau tidak?
Can we become blessings to other people?
Zacchaeus telah menyelamatkan bukan hanya hidupnya.
Zacchaeus saved not only himself.
Tapi dia menyelamatkan rumah tangganya.
But he also saved his household.
Bahkan saya percaya Zacchaeus menyelamatkan kotanya.
I also believe that he saves his city.
Dia telah meninggalkan sesuatu yang berguna bagi orang lain.
He left a legacy for other people.
Katakan amin.
Say amen.
Lalu dikatakan di ayat yang ke-6. Lalu Zacchaeus segera turun dan menerima Yesus dengan sukacita.
So he made haste and came down, verse 6, and received him joyfully.
Bapak Ibu, ketika Tuhan masuk ke dalam kehidupan kita.
So when Jesus entered to our life.
Percayalah ada sukacita.
Believe that there is joy.
Seperti lagu Natal yang mengatakan.
There's a Christmas song that says.
Joy to the world, the Lord is come. Let ever sing us.
Receive her King.
Ah. Bahwa ketika Tuhan datang ke dalam kehidupan kita.
So when God comes into our life.
Ada sukacita yang besar. Ketika Yesus masuk ke dalam kehidupan saya dan istri saya.
When Jesus comes to our life, my life and
my wife. Di dalam rumah tangga kami ada sukacita yang besar.
There is joy in our household, in our marriage.
Orang yang memiliki Yesus dan memiliki sukacita.
Everybody who has Jesus and joy,
kelihatan di wajahnya.
It will be reflected in our face.
Orang yang tidak punya Yesus,
but those who doesn't have Jesus will looks like this.
Tapi orang yang punya Yesus smile.
But those who have Jesus will always smile.
Come on, smile. Oh, open your mask for 30 seconds and smile.
Oh, take your mask off and smile.
Saya mau katakan kepada saudara, jika saudara senyum, dunia ini akan tersenyum.
So when you smile, the world will smile back.
Katakan amin.
Say amen.
Pada satu hari saya mau pergi ke Israel.
One day I was going to Israel.
Saya telepon teman saya di Kairo.
And I called my friend in Cairo.
Bagaimana keadaan di Kairo? Pada waktu itu banyak masalah di sana.
So I asked him how was the situation in Cairo at that time.
Dan dia berkata, mari kita lihat setelah sembahyang hari Jumat.
So he said that let's wait and see until they finish the Friday prayers.
Kalau keadaan tenang, maka tenanglah kota itu.
So he said that if the situation is calm, then the city will be calm after
kalau
the prayers.
Kalau keadaan tidak tenang, ributlah kota itu.
And if the situation is in chaos, then the whole city will also be in chaos.
Saya tanya dia, apa yang kalian lakukan so di tempat ibadahmu?
So I asked my friend, what do you guys do in your temple?
Lihatlah kami orang Kristen.
Oh, look at us, the Christians.
Kalau kami pulang dari gereja,
when we after we come from church,
wajah kami penuh dengan sukacita.
That our face is full of joy.
Katakan amin. Look around. One another, look around. Look his face and his nose. Kekristenan berbicara tentang sukacita.
The Christianity is all about joy.
Sekalipun banyak hal yang tidak baik menimpa kita.
Even though there are many bad things happens in our life.
Hati kita tetap penuh dengan kegirangan dan sukacita.
But our heart must be full of joy.
Tadi pagi saya bersaksi.
This morning I share a testimony.
Tahun 2000 di kota kami.
In the year of 2000 in my town.
Kami merintis gereja dari 20 orang.
I pioneered the church. I planted a church
tahun
from 20 people.
Tahun 2003.
And in 2003.
Gereja itu menjadi 3.000 jemaat.
It multiplied to 3.000.
Dari satu gereja menjadi 84 cabang.
From one church become multiplied to 84 branches.
Kami mempunyai full time lebih dari 100 orang.
We had a full time ministers more than 100 people.
Tahun 2003 pertengahan.
And about the mid-year of 2003.
Ketika kami ada di kota lain,
when we were in another town at that time,
pemimpin kami datang menggantikan saya menjadi gembala.
One of our senior pastor came and took over the ministry.
Pada waktu itu di rumah saya ada microphone seperti ini.
At that time there was one microphone at our house.
Dan itulah satu-satunya benda yang saya bawa keluar dari gereja itu.
And that was the only item that I brought out of the church.
Tuhan memberikan hikmat kepada saya untuk mengatakan,
God gave me wisdom to say,
ladang boleh diambil, panggilan tidak bisa diambil.
That my field can be taken away, but my calling will remain.
Hati saya benar-benar sakit.
I was broken-hearted.
Saya sangat marah dan kecewa.
I was angry and I was disappointed.
Dan tidak melakukan apa-apa sekitar 4 bulan.
But I remained idle for 4 months.
Sampai pada satu hari saya ada di sebuah pulau di Indonesia.
But one day I was on an island in Indonesia.
Saya duduk di ujung sana, di pojok.
I was sitting at the very corner.
Peresmian gereja itu saya yang khotbah salah satunya, yang satu dari Israel.
There was an inaugurations at that church. And I was the speaker.
Ya, yang satu dari Israel.
And one of the speaker was from Israel.
Tetapi hari itu saya duduk di ujung sana sebagai orang yang kalah.
And at that time I felt and I sat on the corner feeling defeated.
Pendeta yang khotbah namanya Jacob Kurin. dari Amerika.
And another speaker who preached at that time from America.
Di altar call kira-kira 15 orang yang mau menjadi pastor.
So he delivered an altar call for those who wants to become a pastor. There are about 15 of them.
Dan tiba-tiba dia menunjuk, you, come.
And all of a sudden, he called out my name.
I said, me? Yes.
And I was...
Because this is wall. Saya duduk sendirian di sana.
I was sitting there alone.
Dan saya maju ke depan.
So I came to the altar.
Orangnya pendek.
The speaker was short.
Dia angkat tangan. You're wasting your time. I do nothing for 4 months. I do nothing. But when he said that, something burned in me. Something burned in me. Dan saya memutuskan, saya akan kembali ke kota saya, dan saya akan buka gereja lagi.
So after that I decided I'm going to return to my city and start the ministry again.
Saudara-saudara, dan kami membangun gereja lagi.
And we started the church again.
Karena panggilan tidak bisa diambil.
Because the calling will remain, will not be taken away.
Pastor Don sudah ada di gereja.
Pastor Don was once at that church.
Belum selesai semuanya karena COVID.
When he was there, it was not fully completed.
Tapi Tuhan pasti akan menolong.
But God will help.
Lantai tujuhnya akan menjadi menara doa.
The seventh store will be
seventh floor.
The seventh floor will be the prayer tower.
Prayer tower. Dan kami bisa melihat keliling. We can look around. Ya.
From the
di
seven.
Depan kami adalah laut.
So in front of us there's an ocean. We're facing the ocean. The building.
So every afternoon we can see the sunset. Okay? Sedang kasih dalam Tuhan. Yang paling menarik adalah Tuhan tetap memberikan kepada kami kemampuan ketika kami kehilangan semua, ya, untuk menghadapi ini.
So what's interesting is God continued to give us the ability even though we lost things, many things at that time.
Sukacita tidak bisa diambil.
But our joy remained at that
ketika
time.
Tuhan bersama-sama dengan kita.
When the Lord is with us.
Saudara, kemarin saya bersaksi bahwa ketika gereja itu diresmikan.
So I witnessed yesterday that when the church was commissioned or inaugurated.
Yeah, the oldest church diresmikan. They invite us, husband and wife.
So the previous church invited us again.
Dan kami duduk di depan, di sebelahnya. Dengan pendeta yang telah menggantikan saya dengan orang lain.
So we were sitting together with the new pastors, you know, who were replaced.
Bukan
us.
Pendeta yang menggantikan saya, yang pendeta dari Surabaya yang memutuskan untuk mengganti saya.
Okay, so we were sitting together with the pastors.
Senior pastor.
With the senior pastors.
Who changed me?
Okay, who took over your ministry?
With another people. Another people. Saudara-saudara, dan yang sangat mengejutkan.
What surprised me?
Kami mengundang Pastor Honey untuk memberi kesaksian tentang gereja ini.
So they called my name out to come up front and then give testimony on that church that they took away from me.
You can imagine what happened in my heart the time. Wow. And the great thing that God give me kemampuan.
So God give me the ability
to come to the altar and make testimony. So many people there said that how come Pastor Honey can go to the altar and make testimony for this church
who used to be yours.
Yang sudah bukan milik saya.
Oh. Yeah.
Yang
I did. Who used to be, yeah. So many people were like, you know, they were surprised. How could he deliver such a testimony in the church that who used to be his?
That is Lord.
That was the Lord.
His namanya Yesus.
And his name is Jesus.
Yang memberikan kemampuan untuk bisa menghadapi ini.
Who give me the courage to handle that situation.
Kalau tidak ada, kalau Tuhan Yesus tidak punya kuasa.
If Jesus doesn't have any power.
Let us fight.
Let us.
I will fight. Okay? I will fight. Tetapi karena Tuhan memberikan kuasa.
But because Jesus give me power.
Pengurapan yang baru.
There's new anointing.
Kami bisa mengatakan jadilah kehendak-Mu Tuhan.
Then I can say let your will be done, Lord.
Wow.
Praise the Lord.
Kita lihat kembali ke cerita tentang Zakheus ini. Ayat yang ke-8, tapi Zakheus mengatakan, setengah dari harta milikku aku berikan kepada orang miskin, dan kalau ada yang aku peras, aku berikan, aku ganti 4 kali lipat.
So in verse 8, Zakheus said, then Zakheus stood and said to the Lord, look, Lord, I give you half of my goods to the poor, and if I have taken anything from anyone by false accusation, I restore fourfold.
Saya berpikir, saudara, pada waktu itu, Zakheus jatuh miskin.
So I thought that at that time Zakheus became poor.
Okay? He lost all his money. Half and half. Okay? Lalu Tuhan bilang begini ayat yang ke-9.
And in verse 9, this is what Jesus said. Today salvation has come to this house because he is also a son of Abraham.
Bapak Ibu, pertanyaannya adalah kenapa bisa terjadi keselamatan kalau kita melepaskan uang?
The question is how could salvation comes when we give our money?
Kalau begitu kita tidak perlu nama Yesus.
So we don't need Jesus then.
Kita cari uang yang banyak.
We can just get more money.
Bagi-bagikan kepada orang miskin.
And then distribute it to the poor.
Bayar utang.
And then pay our debts.
Dan selamat.
And then we were saved.
Bapak Ibu, teologinya tidak seperti itu.
But the theology is not like that.
Pada waktu Yesus belum masuk ke rumah Zakheus.
Before Jesus entered the house of Zakheus.
Yang berkuasa di dalam hidup Zakheus adalah Mammon.
Mammon was the lord of Zakheus at the time before Jesus entered.
Cinta akan uang.
The love of money.
Tapi ketika Tuhan Yesus masuk ke dalam hidup Zakheus.
But when Jesus enters Zakheus' life.
Penguasa lama dikalahkan.
Then the Lord, the old Lord of Zakheus, which is the Mammon, was defeated.
Keluar.
You need to get
apa
out.
Apa buktinya penguasa lama di dalam hidup Zakheus keluar?
And what is the old master of Zakheus?
Ketika dia melepaskan uang.
When he gave the money.
Alkitab bilang begini, engkau tidak dapat mengabdi kepada dua tuan.
The Bible said that we cannot serve two masters.
Kepada Tuhan dan kepada Mammon.
We cannot serve the Almighty God and Mammon.
Kita harus memilih apakah kita cinta Mammon atau cinta Tuhan.
We have to choose whether we love Mammon or love the Lord.
Bagaimana caranya kita membuktikan kita cinta Tuhan? Tuhan masuk ke dalam hati kita.
And how do we know if we love the Lord? We need to let him inside our heart.
Alkitab berkata dengan hati orang percaya dibenarkan.
The Bible says that with our heart we are made righteous.
Dengan mulut orang mengaku dan diselamatkan.
And then with our mouth we acknowledge and we are saved.
Bagaimana caranya mengalahkan Mammon?
How do we defeat Mammon?
Satu-satunya cara mengalahkan Mammon adalah
the only way is
melepaskan Mammon
by leave it out.
Katakan amin. Bapak Ibu, kalau engkau mencintai Mammon lebih dari Tuhan,
when we love Mammon more than the Lord,
maka yang berkuasa dalam hidupmu adalah Mammon.
So Mammon will be our master.
Katakan amin.
Say amen.
Tetapi kalau kita berani melepaskan Mammon, maka Tuhanlah yang berkuasa dalam kehidupan kita.
But if we dare to let go the Mammon, then the Lord will be our master.
Ketika saya memutuskan berhenti bekerja di perusahaan saya bekerja.
When I decided to quit working in the beer company.
It means no more income.
That means no more income.
Tidak ada income.
I have no income.
Tapi saya percaya.
But I believe.
Kami percaya.
We believe.
Tangan Tuhan sanggup untuk menolong kami.
That the hands of God are able to save us, to help us.
Tangan Tuhan sanggup untuk menolong kami.
The hands of God are able to help us.
Dan saya percaya gereja-gereja sedunia mengalami ini, termasuk gereja yang ada di tempat ini.
And I believe that the churches around the world experienced this, including this church.
Ketika COVID itu datang.
When COVID hit us.
Look. COVID, C, Charlie. Delta, D, Delta. O, Omicron. And more. Don't worry. Kenapa? Kita punya Alpha dan kita punya Omega.
Because we have Alpha and Omega.
Amen. Alpha and Omega. Siapa di sini kena COVID?
Who got COVID here? Who has
alumni,
got COVID?
Be alumni. Whoa. Me too. Me too. You know, saya dapat vaksin.
I got vaccines.
Tanggal 14 Januari tahun 2021.
January 14, 2021.
2021. Saya pendeta pertama yang divaksin.
I was the first minister who got vaccines.
Dan setelah divaksin, semua orang bilang, kenapa mau divaksin? Antichrist.
After I got vaccinated, people ask, why would you like to be vaccinated? You're antichrist.
You cannot feel the presence of God.
You cannot
feel. What? Saudara-saudara, saya mengalami. Saya orang nomor 12 yang divaksin di kota saya.
I was the number 12, person number 12 who got vaccinated in my town.
Tahun 2001 bulan 6 saya divaksin yang ketiga. Booster 2021.
Okay, 2021 I got the third booster.
The second booster.
Yeah.
Belum ada istilah booster di kota kami. Saya sudah divaksin yang ketiga.
There was no booster in my town, but I got that booster.
Bulan 7 saya kena COVID.
And then after that, I got COVID.
Saya sudah divaksin 4 kali.
I've been vaccinated 4 times.
Dan Yesus tetap Tuhan saya.
And Jesus is my Lord.
Still my Lord. Amen. So don't worry about that.
So don't worry.
Hallelujah. Ayat yang ke-10, sebab anak manusia datang untuk mencari dan menyelamatkan yang hilang.
First 10, for the Son of Man has come to seek and to save that which was lost.
Sudah tahu setiap kali saya bepergian di Indonesia.
Every time I travel in Indonesia.
Saya membacakan ayat-ayat tentang baptisan air.
I always preach or read about the verses about baptism, water baptism.
Biasanya kalau saya datang ke satu pulau di Indonesia namanya Batam.
When I come to this certain island named Batam.
Dalam satu hari Minggu 500-600 orang dibaptis.
There are about 500 to 600 people got baptized.
Mereka akan baptis mereka dari pagi sampai malam.
And they continue the baptism from morning until the evening time.
Dan di kota-kota lain yang saya pergi, saya cerita tentang baptisan air.
And in many other city when I go, when I travel, I always share the message of water baptism.
Sebelum kami datang ke Manado, kami terbang lagi dari Manado ke Singapura, Singapura tuh ke Batam, dari Batam ke Jakarta, Jakarta Bandung, Bandung Makassar dan selanjutnya.
That was a long trip.
Dan terakhir kami khotbah di gereja yang biasa saya khotbah di Batam, dan hari Minggu itu 124 orang dibaptis.
So the last time when I was preaching in Batam, there was about 124 people got baptized.
Dan hari Seninnya 250
and
orang
dibaptis. And on Monday there was 250 people got baptized.
Sebab anak manusia datang untuk mencari dan menyelamatkan yang hilang.
Because the Son of Man come to seek and save that which was lost.
Mari, saudara-saudara, renungan kita pada hari ini. Kita tetap lapar dan haus akan Tuhan.
Let's continue to be hungry and thirsty for the Lord.
Jangan mamon berkuasa dalam hidup kita.
Don't let mamon become our master.
Dan carilah orang-orang yang belum diselamatkan. Bawalah mereka ke rumah Tuhan, ke gereja.
And bring the lost to the church.
Supaya mereka bisa merasakan apa yang kita rasakan.
So they can experience what we experience with the
dan
Lord.
Dan nama Tuhan yang akan dipermuliakan.
And then the Lord will be glorified.
God bless you all.